Hi, welcome once again to New Directions for Women. This is a program produced by the National Organization for Women, Morris County Chapter in New Jersey. I'm Marvra Stark, and we're going to have a really lovely show tonight. We're going to be talking to a very dear, dear friend of our chapter's. Her name is Paula Kassell. Did I say that right?
You did.
I've known Paula for years and years, and yet I'm still getting this criticism. I don't have her name exactly right. Okay, well, I'd like to tell you from my own point of view that Paula has meant ever so much to our chapter, and you'll see why later on, certainly to this program, and to me personally. She is someone I consider my mentor, as well as very, very dear friend. And now I'd like to tell you a little bit about Paula Kassell. Paula is from our area. She is a graduate of Barnard College, which is the Women's College of Columbia University. She majored in psychology there, and after she graduated, she went to work as a social worker with the Children's Aid Society in Newark. After her youngest child was in school, Paula began a work as a technical editor for Bell Labs, and that is the position she held for 14 years. Then in 1970, Paula was co-founder of Lakeland Area Now, which later became Morris County Now after having merged with another chapter, which was, we think, I thought it was Morristown Now, but Paula tells me no, I'm wrong. It was also called Morris County Now. But in any case, in 1971, Paula became the founder and editor of New Directions for Women, which was a national publication. And before Ms. Magazine came out, New Directions for Women had the largest, it was the largest publication of any feminist national publication. And as a matter of fact, when Paula no longer published New Directions for Women, she was gracious enough to lend us the name, or give us the name, to our show, which our show was originally called Morris County Now Presents, and we changed it, thanks to Paula, for New Directions for Women, since we were getting a much wider audience than just Morris County. Paula is currently vice president of the Women's Institute for Freedom of the Press. And that's a lot. quite an accomplished person. So you grew up, am I correct, it was around here?
Oh, no, I grew up in Yonkers, New York.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
Ah, and I'm under the impression that you've been in Dover.
Oh, when I got married, I moved to Dover. My husband was a Doverite.
Okay, so how long now have you been in Dover?
Since 1941.
Okay. Well, that qualifies as a native,
right,
as far as I'm concerned. And I was wondering about your early family background when you were with your parents. Was there anything in that background that somehow indicated to you that feminism, even though maybe at that time there was no word for it, but it was a direction you felt strongly about?
Well, I think my father influenced me. He didn't have any sons. I had one sister, and he pushed us to achieve and always told us that we should have a profession and be able to take care of ourselves and not have to depend on a man. So that was a feminist attitude from my father. And in those days, not many girls were sent to college, but he insisted that we go to college. And my sister and I both went to Barnard, which was a very feminist place back then. She graduated in 31. I graduated in 39.
What was so feminist about Barnard?
Well, you know, later on the feminist movement questioned this. They told us, they imbued us with the idea that we could do everything. We could have a profession and excel in that. We could have a family, we could have children, and we would be able to do everything. which we did actually, but of course later on when the movement got a little bit thoughtful about these things, we realized that that was a terrible burden to put on the woman of the family.
Yes.
But we accepted that.
Yeah.
And we carried it out.
Wow. And especially in those days when generally most men were not amenable to taking their share of household responsibilities. Well, were there any other influences or influences in particular that led you even further into feminism?
The main influence on my thinking and my philosophy was a book I read when I was a freshman in college written by Margaret Mead and called Sex and Temperament in Three Primitive Societies. And she told about these three tribes in New Guinea which stereotyped the sexes in three different ways, although they were all in New Guinea. One tribe, both the men and the women were brought up to be very aggressive, and one tribe, the men and the women were both brought up to be very feminine, actually. And in the third tribe, the men and the women were brought up one sex to be feminine and one sex to be very masculine, aggressive, but the sexes were reversed. It was the women who were the aggressive and the supporters and the men who danced and made flower arrangements. And so I said to myself, if the societies can mold people in all those different ways, then I can mold myself however I want to be and not adhere to the sex stereotyping of our own society.
Yeah.
And that changed my whole life, that book.
Hmm. Wow. And I guess even it could, this is society, it's not only that we as individuals mm-hmm. can choose more of what we want our faiths to be, but the society as a whole has more flexibility.
Well, that was the way the feminist movement was designed at the very beginning, was to have a choice that each individual should be able to choose whatever way he or she wanted to go and not have to be a certain personality or adhere to the culture's stereotypes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, you worked at Bell Labs for quite some time, and at a time when I would say most women were in the home with their children.
Right.
And, you know, of course, we hear a great deal about discrimination in the workplace now. I wonder how much of it you encountered at that time.
Well, at that time at the labs, there were hardly any women in even middle management, no less upper management. I had a job at the lowest rank of in the management area, and I expected to be given a promotion. I thought I deserved a promotion, and I was the most capable person, I thought, to handle the job, but I was passed over in favor of a man, of course, and so I quit. So there I think there was a lot of discrimination, sex discrimination in the labs, as there were in most companies in those days. It was before the days of affirmative action.
Okay. Well, did you have any recourse within the company when you were passed over? Did you make it known to anyone that you felt you had been treated unfairly and that perhaps they could rectify?
Well, at the time I quit, I didn't really tell them that was why I was quitting, but I did say that I had wanted to be considered for that job, and I was very disappointed.
And why did you tell them you were leaving?
I told them I was leaving because my youngest child had graduated from college, and our financial situation in my family was such that I didn't need to work anymore.
Mm, yeah, yeah. It's kind of, you know, when you hear it now, it's such a somehow a phrase, well, some people I'm sure use it, or the woman works because she has to.
Right.
And once the family major burdens of the family financially are complete, then she no longer needs to
work.
Yes,
but the funny thing is, after I quit and got involved in the feminist movement, I worked harder than I had ever done in my life.
Okay. let's begin to talk about that now. We are now post Bell Labs. And one of the things that you did that I alluded to before was that you were a co-founder of Lakeland Area Now. Could you tell us what area did that encompass, Lakeland
It was it was the western part of Morris County, Dover and west of that.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, there was a chapter called Morristown Now, which later became Morris County Now.
Okay.
But we still continue to be Lakeland Area Now.
So there were two chapters
right.
in operation in the county.
That's right.
One that had begun as Morristown Now and then had changed to Morris County Now and then Lakeland Area
mm-hmm.
Now.
Mm-hmm.
And was there any particular reason why these groups weren't together to begin with, weren't one chapter to begin with?
I don't know whether I should say this, but I didn't quite like the way the Morristown area, Morristown Now, was operating and publicizing themselves. And so I started with another woman. I started a rival chapter,
uh-huh.
which became a very active chapter.
Okay. And whatever happened to the other woman? Is she around?
No, she's lost. I tried very hard to find her when we were celebrating an anniversary of the chapter, and she's just lost from sight. I don't know whether she's living, but we lost her completely.
Mm. Oh, that's a shame. So you began Lakeland Area Now, and how active were you?
I was not active in the chapter. I had gotten involved in other things, and there were other women who were ready to be leaders and could take over the chapter and run it. So I never had an office in that chapter.
Okay. What were some of the accomplishments of Lakeland Area Now?
They were very big on employment discrimination. They actually filed a suit with the Mars company because a woman came to us and complained about discrimination but didn't want to file suit herself. And we did, that suit was settled in her favor.
Mm-hmm.
And we did many other things in the employment area.
Okay. Then, what happened to create the entity we have now, which is the current Morris County Now?
Well, Morris County Now became a very inactive chapter, and Lakeland Area Now was still active and had leadership, and so they sort of went out of business, and with the consent of the women who had been leaders there, Lakeland Area Now took over and became Morris County Now.
Wow.
Now, I think we're spending a little too much time on this, and we should get on to
the rest
of what happened.
Okay, Paula. Don't blame me if at the end we're sitting here with nothing to say.
Oh, just the opposite.
Okay.
We're going to have too much to say.
Okay. Well, but I find that interesting.
Yeah.
I really do, about how you know, the history of this chapter. You know, I've been in this chapter for years, and yet these are some things I never knew about the chapter. Okay, now, while you were still involved with Lakeland Area Now, you, I think, were the force behind a conference.
Yes.
Of, was this employers and unions?
Yes, we... under the name of the National Organization for Women, and with the help of the president of NOW at that time, I got an idea that affirmative action had just been passed and had to be implemented, and I got the idea that we should do a conference for New Jersey employers and unions on how to implement affirmative action correctly, especially regarding women. And actually, we put together a very successful conference. We had about 50 employers. The big companies in New Jersey came. Some unions came. And the nice thing about it was that we cleared over $1,000. Over $1,000 went into the National Now Treasury. And in 1970, $1,000 was a lot of money. And I think we did something very important in talking to the employers in New Jersey on a friendly basis and a helpful basis, and that they came to us for help rather than a confrontational.
On affirmative action.
Yes.
You know, it's interesting, after so many years, we're still having misunderstandings and problems in regard to affirmative action, but I suppose that'll go on for a while.
I suppose.
Yeah. And then I believe this was with the state chapter of NOW, and I'm not sure, but it was with the help of one of the chapters of NOW.
Now, the
was Lakeland, it
Lakeland? Yeah, the women in the Lakeland area chapter formed the committee to put on this conference.
Okay. Was this the conference of, wasn't the employers and unions conference?
Yes, that's what I'm
saying. Oh, okay, yeah. They did. And they also did another conference, which, because I remember, because it was called New Directions
right.
for Women in New Jersey.
That's where the name came from. Yes, I had the idea that we should have a statewide conference on all the feminist issues. And one of the women from the Princeton area chapter thought up that wonderful name, New Directions for Women in New Jersey. The New Directions for Women, I think, is a wonderful name. It expresses just what we're all about. And we did put on a conference, and about 350 women came, and that was a lot of women for 1971.
Yes.
We had many, many workshops. And keynote speakers. That was a very happy, successful conference. People told me afterwards that it changed their lives.
Mm-hmm.
So after that conference, the women who had done the publicity came to me and said, "I've thought of your next job, Paula. You should start a newspaper to keep all these women together, to keep in touch with all of them and bring some more women out of the woodwork." And so as we evaluated the conference afterwards, we had cleared about $350 or something like that. And we decided to send $100 to National Now, because they had sent women task force people up to do workshops, and again the president, or at that time she called herself Chair One of NAC.
Chair One?
Chair One.
I'm sorry, I shouldn't laugh, because you know, I'm sure at that time,
you know,
people
she
were kind of at
she
a...
didn't just want to say chair, and she didn't want to say chair man or chair woman. Somehow she dreamed up Chair One. Anyway, she came and gave a keynote. So we gave $100 to NOW, and there was $240 left, and they said, "Here, Paula, take this and start a newspaper."
Wow. And let me ask you, did you have any experience with being a newspaper
run? Well, at college I worked on the college newspaper and the yearbook. In high school I worked on the newspaper. I was news editor of the high school paper. But I had no professional experience, and I was so naive, we all were, that I didn't realize we were starting a business. We had no idea how to get circulation, how to get advertising. It was just the overwhelming desire to get all this information we had out to women so we could make feminists of everybody. Mm-hmm. And so we just did it. I don't know. We just learned on the job. Talk mm-hmm. about learning on the job.
Baptism by fire.
Yes. But I must say the professional women in advertising and publicity and circulation production in New York, luckily we're near New York, I got on the phone and found some of them and talked to them, and they were extremely helpful in telling us what to do and how to go about things. I remember one woman in particular helped us to price our advertising space. You know, she said, well, for a publication, she was worked for a book publisher. She said, for a publication like yours, I would probably want to add 2 columns by 4 inches, and I would want to pay whatever it was, $60 or whatever. And from that one figure, my son was in advertising at that time, and he devised our advertising fee schedule just extrapolating from that one figure. And he, instead of having charging by the inch, column inch, as most publications did, he devised a scheme where a sliding scale, and throughout the life of the paper, we used that same principle. It worked very well for us.
So it was a matter of not only learning to put together a newspaper, but to run a business.
Yes.
And I think that's what you stressed to me when we talked about it before. And that's really interesting. I mean, Marth County now certainly is an organization, but it isn't a business.
Yes.
So speaking business is quite something. Well, I have to say that New Directions for Women was a publication that I subscribed to long before I met you mm-hmm. or had any idea that you had anything to do with it. And I would get it, and I have to say that it really drastically changed my life, because I remember at one time you did an issue which was devoted to feminist spirituality, mm-hmm. and most of the articles were along those lines, and there were many contacts that you gave. There were few in New Jersey, there were lots in California, there were lots in Boston. And that began me on my search to reach other women who were interested.
Right.
And as it turns out, that right here in New Jersey is a very strong center of influence mm-hmm. Of feminist spirituality. And but how does one know?
Yeah.
You know, it took a lot of research to find that out. And I owe it all, really, to New Directions for Women.
Oh, we heard from so many women that this article or that article and this information or that information had changed their lives. That was a phrase we heard all the time. And I want to say, when you first asked me to do this program, I thought, I'm going to come on and talk about myself for a half an hour. I mean, but when I thought about it, I realized that what we were doing at the early days of the feminist movement, very important to be documented, and the fact that we were doing things that we didn't know how to do, but we had to do them, so we learned how to do them, is a wonderful lesson to other women that can be applied today. And I personally heard, especially at that wonderful 80th birthday party that the chapter gave me, and women came and told me how I had helped them. One woman in particular said, you gave me an assignment to write an article. And I said, I can't do that. And I said, yes, you can. Mm-hmm. You can do it and do it. And so she was almost forced to do it, but she did it successfully. And ever after that, she wrote because she found out she could do it. So it made me feel absolutely wonderful to know that I had that influence on.
Paula, could you just, excuse me, very, very briefly, just let us know how you single-handedly got the New York Times to use Ms. rather than Miss and Mrs. If you can do it quickly.
Yes. Well, I bought stock in the New York Times, 10 shares of stock, so I could go to the stockholders meeting. At that time, the women at the Times had a suit, a discrimination suit against the Times. And the Times had settled and promised to advance to women over a period of 3 years. And I went, they gave me the information I needed to go to the stockholders meeting and say, now this department isn't keeping up with its promises. This department did very well. And I really represented the Times Women's Caucus at the stockholders meeting for a couple of years. That was the main reason why I bought the stock. But then, you know, for years, other publications had started using Ms. The Times absolutely refused, mostly because of the executive editor, who was very much against it. So I decided to go to the meeting and talk about that. And the man who conducted the meeting, Arthur Ox Sulzberger, who's the chair of the board of the Times, one of the things I said was, when your daughter got married, she retained her name. And he nodded yes. And I said, did she become Mrs. Sulzberger?
Mm.
And he said, I'm still trying to figure that out.
Mm-hmm.
So about, I don't think it was more than a month or so, maybe less, after that meeting, I got a letter from him saying that the Times would use Ms.
Oh,
and
how
you know,
wonderful.
I know, you know, the thing I did for the Times and Ms. is the thing I'm more famous for than anything else I did in the movement, excluding the 23 years that I worked on New Directions for Women.
Okay, Paula, I'm just so delighted that you were able to come tonight and spend some time with us, and I want everybody to know who our mother was, or certainly one of our mothers.
Have we used up all our time?
Yes, would you believe?
Can I say one more thing?
If it's real quick.
I want to say that my husband was the most wonderful man and backed me in everything I did and helped me with everything I did, and that I could not have done what I did without him. We had a wonderful feminist equal marriage.
That's wonderful. I want to say bye-bye to everybody. I hope you enjoyed our program for Women's History Month, and we're going to see you next time, we hope. So bye for now. And I guess that's it. Well, we almost had...